Now on BBC One, Desmond Lynam follows the road to Wembley in Match of the Day.
Good evening. FA Cup weekend. Once again, it's football with that knockout punch. Now, I don't know if you noticed, but he did get the job. All going well so far, Terry?
It wasn't in doubt, was it?
No doubt whatsoever. More from Terry a little later. Now, in the Cup, we feature some of the big guns on a hiding to nothing, like Aston Villa, away to First Division Grimsby.
Good left foot ball in, and there were two right in on Bosnich. And all of them missed it.
Manchester City at Second Division Cardiff.
Now this is Damon Searle coming more into the game. The left fullback. Now this is Miller. Best chance of the game so far.
And the third favourites for the Cup, Blackburn at the Valley to take on Charlton Athletic.
This is Leeburn. Walsh is there too. It fell for Pitcher. Oh, he's hit the post. And this is Robson.
We're at the all-premiership tie between Ipswich and Spurs. And we take a look at the remaining non-league side involved, Kidderminster. We have goals from five other ties. Hansen and Brooking here to discuss. Right, we begin at Blundell Park, where Grimsby Town had lost just once this season. The visitors, Aston Villa, with one of the best away records in the Premiership. The commentary comes from Tony Gubba.
Half of Villa's players have already tasted cup defeat at the hands of Grimsby. Beaten over two legs in the League Cup two seasons ago. A Dave Gilbert penalty was the away goal that put them out in a 1-1 draw at Villa Park after the match here had also been drawn 0-0. Well, one of Grimsby's three injury doubts for today's match has made it. Top scorer Clive Mendonca will play, but two didn't. Number two, Tony Ford, replacing John McDermott at right back, and number seven, Gary Childs, in on the right side of midfield in place of Tommy Watson. Villa, who needed a Dean Saunders penalty to win away at Exeter in the last round, are unchanged for the third successive game. Another chance then for Tony Daly to exploit his pace down the left flank. Saunders and Atkinson up front have so far scored 21 goals, and five of the team have already been FA Cup winners with clubs like Liverpool, Manchester United and Everton. Ian Hemley of Bedfordshire is the referee, and although these two teams have been taking part in the FA Cup since the last century, this is the first time they've met in this competition. And here's Grimsby with the first attack, and the attempted shot from top scorer Mendonca was deflected. That took the pace off it, and now Tony Daly with the bandage on the right wrist, trying to get down that touchline for the first time. Average gates here are just over 6,000, but this afternoon it's just under 16, bringing record receipts of £120,000. Tim Dobbin and Charles. This is Livingston. Well, he'd have had to do well to have beaten a keeper of the quality of Mark Bosnich from there, but it was an indication of the striker's instinct for goal. Only one thing in his mind when that ball fell to him. The head of Handysides. Futcher, who knocks it up. And there was a little flick on from Mendonca, and Bosnich forced to come out of his area. Two, Grimsby currently 18th in the First Division. That's a free kick. And meeting a Villa side who slipped down to 10th in the Premier League, having been as high as second as recently as November. But Villa have only taken 9 points from the last 30 in the Premier League. Croft onto it quickly and gets it back. A neat little back heel as well. Groves. It's broken to Livingston. He managed to get in the shot, but he was under all sorts of pressure from Sean Teal. Livingston, whose father Joe used to be a professional player back in the 60s, went for the foot of the near post. Tony Ford, who'd stayed forward, looking for Livingston. And he took it. Got Mendonca behind him, but he's facing the wrong way. Sure if that's exactly what he intended. May have just been trying to cut it back into the penalty area. In the end, it was only just over the bar. Ron Atkinson standing up already. Delian Atkinson. Teal. Straight to Tony Ford. And it's Grimsby who are showing the most flair and imagination in these first 10 minutes. Childs again. Livingston, oh, we nearly got it back to him. Groves, Tony Ford available out on the right. This is pleasing to the home crowd. Well, you'll do well to outrun Daly. And it's Miller who get the throw. Maybe Tony Ford would have done better to just knock that in at the first opportunity rather than trying to outrun the Villa player. This is Townsend. And cut out by Futcher. This is Dobbin. Childs. Well, didn't quite work that time. Saunders leaves it. Well, looks as though he was going to leave it for Atkinson, but now here's Atkinson testing the pace of Handysides, and he's got away from Peter Handysides. Houghton's in the middle, must score. 1-0 Villa, and it was clinical. Ray Houghton milks the praise, his fourth goal of the season, but number five, Peter Handysides, was just caught out by the persistence and the strength and the pace of Delian Atkinson. And that's a big disappointment for the 19-year-old Scottish under-21 international. And maybe it's an early warning as well of the quality that there is in the Villa side, and having taken that lead early in the match, that will help Villa to settle the nerves, and maybe this cup tie at Grimsby won't be the ordeal that it might otherwise have been. Alan Buckley, well, he's enjoyed giant killing exploits in the FA Cup as a player. Rose back to Futcher. Teal took an elbow then from Livingston. I don't think there can be any doubt about it. He reacted very angrily and Livingston responded, and that was a very ugly flashpoint. And at first judgment from the commentary box, Livingston guilty of jumping with his elbows up. And that's something which is a real talking point in the game, which both the Professional Footballers Association and the FA and the Football League indeed are trying to stamp out. And Teal, I'm sure, is getting his point across that the head-to-head afterwards was a direct result of the elbow. And the shirt on his back is in absolute tatters. I mean, there was real anger in the flashpoint. And what will Ian Hemley decide is the fitting punishment for either player? And there's looks of concern on the face of Ron Atkinson, because there must be a possibility of both of them going. And the way Sean Teal's reacting, that is the outcome. And that is a disappointing incident early on in a match which had been entertaining and good football. but the elbow was up. There can't be any question of that. And Teal was very angry, having taken one across the bridge of the nose. What followed, the referee decided, was unforgivable, and they're both off. That'll be a very big disappointment to Sean Teal, I can tell you. And maybe, well, the referee will feel he's acted in the letter of the law, but maybe a firm word would have been a better outcome. Maybe the yellow card for Livingston. But it's two teams of 10 who will have to battle out the remaining three quarters of this match. Townsend. And Houghton up to Townsend. And for the moment, Villa have pulled Kevin Richardson back to play in the heart of the defence alongside McGrath. They've got Neil Cox and Dwight York on the substitutes bench. And yes, Villa have decided instantly to make a change. Cox is a more accomplished defender. He comes on to replace Tony Daly. And now it looks as if Earl Barrett has moved into the centre of defence. Cox has gone right back. And Richardson has resorted to midfield again. There's Neil Cox, former Scunthorpe trainee, so he's local to the area. Childs trying to tee somebody up. It was behind Childs. Gilbert's on it. Another corner. And the double sending off seems to have unsettled Villa a little bit more than Grimsby at the moment. Corner taken short. Here's Ford. Good left foot ball in. And there were two right in on Bosnich. And all of them missed it. Well, that could absolutely have gone anywhere, couldn't it? And Donker was in. So too was Paul Groves. They both missed it, as did the keeper. Here's Groves. Only Mendonca ahead of him. That's for Mendonca to chase. Barrett's sprinting across to cover him. Groves peels off. This is Childs. Pulled it down very well. Ford. Again, it's good football from Grimsby. Oh, Mendonca. He looked as if he was pushed. And Grimsby have appealed. Ford who knocked it in. Now, how much contact was there between him and Earl Barrett? Maybe not that much. And that looks like Dwight York taking off the bottom half of the tracksuit, which may mean another substitution. This is the moment when Dean Saunders picked up his injury. Nobody was near him at the time. It was a twist, maybe in the small of the back, but it's sufficient to mean that Dean Saunders cannot continue, and so Dwight York will come on. So Villa have been forced to use both their outfield substitutes. Futcher, as we move into a second minute of stoppage time in this first half. Time, Villa lead by 1-0. The slip by Peter Handysides, which allowed Atkinson in, and he delivered the ball to Ray Houghton. But Villa going off at half time without three of the players who started the match. Teal sent off, Saunders injured, and Daly pulled off as well. So there's a lot of talking to do in the dressing room for Ron Atkinson, even though his team lead here by 1-0. Grimsby have only suffered one home defeat here at Blundell Park this season, beaten here 1-0 by Charlton back in October. But equally, they've only won three of 12 home league games in Division 1, and most of their results here have been drawn. 12 matches drawn in all out of 26. So, on that evidence, a draw the most likely outcome against Villa. We shall see if they can finally get a goal. And Neil Cox. Some of the passion has just gone out of this match. And that will be of benefit to Villa, I would have thought. A goal to the good. To outjump Mendonca. This is Childs. Nice touch by Groves. Barrett had covered and Groves got away from him. Paul Groves. Grimsby have equalised. And it's always been on the cards. And it's as if somebody has suddenly ignited the whole of the crowd. There was the first touch from Groves. And then Barrett looked favourite, but somehow he tucked it round him and he beat Bosnich for his seventh goal of the season. And with over half an hour left to play, the team from Division 1 have it back level, one apiece against the team from the Premier Division. Groves got a bit of it, Barrett lost it. Who had the last touch? Corner. And it's Gilbert who's jogging across to take this for Grimsby. Tony Ford is close to him, but looks as if he's going to knock it into the box. That was technically short. Gilbert again. Flick on by Groves, McGrath, and Villa survive. And Futcher will have to use the keeper. McGrath again the saviour, and it was Groves who got the little flick on, and McGrath who acrobatically got it out. Rayhouten. Richardson free in the middle. It was Gilbert who got into him. Childs. Groves has shown some good touches. Mendonca with McGrath. Oh, Paul McGrath, immaculate. And didn't that little moment just sum up what a good match McGrath's had and how important he's been to them? Here's Atkinson, who's peeled away from Futcher. Dwight York out wide on the left, just the two of them forward, there's nobody else here for Villa. Maybe they don't need anybody else. Dwight York! It's a killer blow, it's cruel, but Villa lead by 2-1. And Dwight York, only his third appearance of the season. Only used as a substitute, twice in recent matches, and then on this afternoon when he was required. Handyside slipped, he went wide of Futcher, and from just inside the penalty area, beat Crichton at the foot of the post. It was an excellent goal with 12 minutes left, and it's given Villa that little bit of space in which to breathe. But that goal came only seconds after what, for me, was a match-saving tattle by Paul McGrath at the other end. Under real pressure from Mendonca, he just got his foot on it and got it back to his keeper. To Rahab. Shakespeare in pursuit. And the ball off the Grimsby player. Villa with another throw. And a few more seconds eaten up. Dwight York. Villa in full voice as the match moves into stoppage time. Cox. Dwight York, the goal scorer. In possession on the final whistle. Ron Atkinson's team are through to the fifth round of the FA Cup, but it was a close run thing, and both sets of supporters applaud what's been a really fine match. McGrath was absolutely outstanding in the second half. The goal from Paul Groves kept the Grimsby dream alive for 21 minutes until Dwight York knocked in that second Villa goal on 78 minutes. When Villa had been pressed back on defence for long spells, in the end, another tidy performance by Villa, who had to win away at Exeter in the third round, and winning away here at First Division Grimsby in round four. Dwight York accepts all the congratulations, and it's a happy journey home for Aston Villa. Final score, Grimsby 1, Aston Villa 2.
Regardless of the rights and wrongs of the incident, Teal was sent off along with Livingston. How did you feel about that?
Well, I suppose it was inevitable. I mean, players can't raise the fist to each other. They looked a bit of squabbling after the thing as opposed to actual fists, but the referee, in his wisdom, I mean, a lot of people might have just said, let's book him, calm the thing down and let play go on.
No one was badly injured. He could have booked us both and just said, look, be careful and get on with it. I've gone up for the header and Steve Livingston's come across, and his elbow's clearly up. And the worst thing for me is I can see the elbow coming. And whether Steve means it or not, I mean, the elbow's there and there's not much I can do about it. It's going to hit me, and in fact, it does hit me.
Where did it hit you?
Just above me left eye. I mean, not hard, albeit, but, I suppose it incensed me a bit, really.
Well, a word about that in a moment, Trev, but first of all, Grimsby have got a recent tradition of playing nice football, and they played quite nice football there, but it wasn't good enough for them.
Yeah, well, their manager, Alan Buckley, has always tried to encourage his players to pass, and, I mean, they started superbly in the opening 10 and 11 minutes. In fact, the actual goal that Villa got was almost their first attack. And I think sometimes when you look at sides that come up into the Premier League, the managers say some of the difference is that they get punished for their mistakes by quality strikers, and I think we saw that not only with Dwight York's winner, but, in fact, the opening goal. I mean, Dalian Atkinson's pace definitely caused the young central defender, Peter Handyside, huge problems. Here, Dean Saunders knocks it back. You see Dalian Atkinson there just jogging, and as he stop him there, I mean, what, is he 5 yards behind Peter Handyside? And as the ball's knocked over the top, look at the yards that he takes out the defender. And I think the defender thinks, well, I've got a couple of yards here, I'm OK, but he just loses his concentration. Dalian Atkinson does exceptionally well, then unselfishly squares it, and even we would have had a chance of putting that one in as Ray Houghton, very grateful. But, you know, that quality, I think, you know, in the strikers is the important factor. Now, we've got the sending off here. And as soon as I saw this, as you see Steve Livingston going up, he leads with the elbow. He's not looking at the ball. And as Sean Toole heads it, there's only going to be one point of contact, the elbow. And as soon as I saw it, I think to myself, well, he's got to have the red card. And it was just a question then. You see Sean Toole swing his arm around as they go down. He didn't make contact then. After that, it's a fairly firm grip, I must say. But, I mean, Paul McGrath does very well to try and pull him away. And all those players coming in are actually just trying to separate them more than anything else. And it's just a question now whether the referee sends off Sean Teal as well for retaliation. Personally, I don't think it should have been equal punishment. I think Livingston definitely should have got the red card and Sean Teal a yellow.
Those elbowing offences are so dangerous, as it has been proved already then. Well, Francis Lee, the one-time Manchester City favourite, has completed his deal to take over his old club, but of course the team's in desperate trouble, struggling in the relegation area in the league, and today facing a tough cup tie away to Cardiff City. Cardiff beat Middlesbrough after a replay in round three, you recall. City had Keith Curl, their central defender, back in the side. We pick up the action in the first half. Cardiff in the blue, commentary from Ian Brown.
A Manchester City free kick on the halfway line. There's the offender, Paul Miller. And the free kick is launched by Kernahan. He's looking for Vok, and that's a fine header by Vok. But it was well grasped by Mark Grew. The sort of save you'd expect him to make, really. But it was a firm header, and he did have to stretch quite a way there. The way to his left to hang on. This is Thompson, turns into Rocastle, but still finds Hazelwood. And now this is Damon Searle coming more into the game. The left fullback. Now then, this is Miller! Best chance of the game so far. It was Paul Miller arriving from nowhere, really, in the centre forward's position to drill in the low shot. Not quite the power behind it, and too close to Coton, who's a classy goalkeeper, and made the save. Bradley, the touch on from Richardson, takes it into the path of Keith Curl. Curl is onside, of course, because he played it himself. He has three at the back post. One of them is Vonk. This is Vonk, and this is Flitcroft, and that's away. It was a great run by Keith Curl, beautifully played by him. Vonk causing problems, and there we are, blocked on the line. Richardson seeing a lot of the ball, and Nathan Blake just betrayed slightly by his first touch, but it will be Cardiff City's ball again. Nathan Blake, sweet turn by Blake, he's still got it, that's a corner, and that is a quite magnificent goal by Nathan Blake. The jewel in the Cardiff City crown has glittered quite magnificently. Manchester City of the Premiership are stunned by some Blake magic. The second division side lead by 1-0, and what a goal. Well, you can hardly hear yourself think here at Ninian Park. We had, 63 minutes on the watch when Nathan Blake supplied that moment of inspiration for Cardiff City. Now they need to concentrate from this corner, away by Hazelwood. Lomas with a shot, that's a wicked deflection, problems here, Vonk miscues, it's still not away, Curl is in there, and this time it's Nathan Blake on defensive duty to get it away. Back in by Kernahan, offside flag is up on the far side, the offside flag is up on the far side, Curl is denied, it is no goal. Manchester City thought they'd made the immediate response, but the flag was up absolutely immediately as the ball was played in by Kernahan. And that was close, but maybe the linesman just about got it right. It looks as though Mike Sheeran will be entering the fray for Manchester City. And it's the Norwegian Ingebrigtsen, Kåre Ingebrigtsen, who has departed. There he goes. Richardson, Blake again, turns it on towards Cohen Griffith. Oh, he just got the touch there, but Coton was so brave. Coton was off his line there, so athletically, to close down the angle. I think Griffith did just get a quite slight touch on the ball there. Reception for Andrew Dibble. So Manchester City have used both their substitutes now, and they have 18 minutes to rescue the game, and straight away Dibble has to face a Cardiff City corner. Not the ideal introduction. It's Miller looking for Thompson, away firmly by Flitcroft. Hazelwood, Lomas, and he's brought to earth there by Paul Miller, and Miller reacts angrily. There was no need for that really from the Cardiff City player. They just need to calm down a little bit. Cardiff a little bit over exuberant, and why not? They do lead by a goal to nil, but the aggression has to be channeled positively. Rocastle though for Manchester City. It's still Rocastle. Will it open up for Rocastle? It's a penalty. The penalty has been awarded for the trip on Rocastle. understandable frustration from the Cardiff City bench that Rocastle was beginning to really open up a situation from which he might have had a strike at goal. All of a sudden his legs disappeared. Now then, can the Manchester City captain Keith Curl beat Mark Rue and give them an FA Cup lifeline? Great save by Mark Rue! And this is turning into a memorable afternoon for Cardiff City. But it's a day on which everything is going wrong for Manchester City. Back in there by Vonk, who's now playing in the back four. He swapped places with Curl. Now then, Nathan Blake, can he time the ball forward? No, Griffith didn't continue the run. This now is Griffith. Forward towards Nathan Blake. Oh, he's taken that beautifully in his stride. What about the finish? Still Blake. Oh, he's pulled it wide. Cardiff City on the break here, absolutely rampant. That first touch took out the defender. The second touch took out another one, but he couldn't beat Dibble. This is Lomas now on the right-hand side. Good run into space from Flitcroft. Curl's header, and there is Mark Rue again. Keith Curl, a free header. But it was too close to Rue, and maybe Manchester City's last chance has passed, and they're on their way out of the FA Cup. And that's it. A famous, famous result for Cardiff City. Nathan Blake's magical goal has taken them through to the fifth round of the FA Cup for the first time in 17 years.
The first 10, 15 minutes was a bit cat and mouse, which you expect. It was important for us not to concede a goal because, obviously, you know, we wanted to keep it as tight as possible. We didn't want them to get their tails up early on. We kept it tight, as I say, for the first 15, 20 minutes, and then we started to impose ourselves on the game, and we played some great football. And second half, as I say, I felt up until the goal, I thought we were much the better side. I mean, we deserved the win.
Well, they did play well, but Man City aren't having too much luck at the moment.
No, not at all. But as you say, great result for Cardiff. Mm. It was a super performance, and really the goal was a classic from Blake. And I don't think anybody would relish going there in the next round. Mm.
Now, Keith Curl was back in the Manchester City side today, and he was involved in a couple of incidents that you've pulled out for us.
Yeah, this is the first one. This is Kernaghan on the ball. He just throws it into the box. We freeze it here, and it's badly in the right-hand side of the picture. I think he's playing everybody onside. It comes over the top. He misses it. Curl comes in. He just toe-pokes it past Grew, and I thought the goal was perfectly legitimate.
So did the referee,
linesman,
I think.
The linesman gave offside. And this is the second one. We have Rocastle, nobody challenges him. He goes into the box. Searle comes in. I think he just falls over here. But the referee has no hesitation in giving a penalty kick. I thought it was a bit dubious myself, but Keith Curl stands up. And I think just a nice height for Grew here. I think it's a decent save, but a nice height. And he'll be disappointed with that. And then, of course, he has a great header at the end that Grew saved as well. So, he could have had a couple of goals there.
So they have got problems, City. Now, Liverpool have got problems too. Manager's job, you?
No, I've got a great amount of affinity for the club. They're a great club, tremendous supporters, but I just don't want it to be a manager.
So you're out of it. Roy Evans is in it, is that right?
He'd be a logical choice for me.
Mm-hmm. OK, it looks that way. Now, once upon a time, they had 75,000 at the Valley for a cup tie. Today, the crowd limit was just 8,500 as Charlton took on in-form Blackburn Rovers. Number 8, Carl Leeburn, is the Charlton top scorer on 10 goals. Alan Shearer has scored more than half Blackburn's goals with 26 and 13 in the last 10 games. These teams second in their respective divisions, and John Motson is the commentator.
Leeburn. Oh, didn't Nicky Marker hold him back? Well, if he did, the referee decided it wasn't intentional. Leeburn just threatened to go past the last man here. Now then, Marker, well, did he throw himself a bit?
Berg.
Well, if Grant was fouled, Charlton had possession. Pitcher. And Leeburn forces Lassau to concede a corner. Really depends on the delivery, this, with so many big men in there at the near post. On by Brown, and the header clutched by Flowers from Leeburn, who complained about a bit of shirt pulling there, but this is a flick on. I think it's 24 Brown, actually, who makes his presence felt here. Yes, Leeburn. Oh, look at that. There was a pull on the shirt of Leeburn. Was it by Sherwood? Pardew. Was it hands by Batty? Apparently not. Pardew again. Outside him, Robson. Moran's header out from Grant. Pardew battles to win it back. Referee says play on. Ripley for Blackburn. Three up with him. But he's run where? Well, into trouble, really. And with an hour gone, that very promising Blackburn attack came to nothing. Now Grant, and another good piece of defending by Nicky Marker. Still a paucity of scoring chances, but Grant works a way to create one here, and that's about the best Charlton have had. Robson now. Nice turn. Well, that flew invitingly across the six-yard box from Kim Grant. Brown. Leeburn couldn't make contact. McCleary did. Pitcher. McCleary. Brown. Arms up on the far side of the penalty area. This is Leeburn. Walsh is there too. It fell for Pitcher. Hit the post, and this is Robson, and Leeburn comes piling in corner. Good defending by Moran underneath the bar, but Pitcher came as close as anybody to opening the scoring in this cup tie. It was a fine effort, and it's not over yet, this Charlton attack. They're pushing people up for the corner. Leeburn comes in, still Leeburn. Oh, and Flowers saves. Leeburn again. And Flowers again. Oh, dear, oh dear, that's a let-off for the Premiership team, without a doubt. Wilcox. And that came off McCleary for the corner, and Blackburn, having had one escape, may now feel the time has come to slightly enforce their presence. Moran didn't quite make it. Ripley. It's a bit short from David Batty. Leeburn is still in defence at the moment. Batty gets it back. Oh, that's a foul. The challenge on Leeburn by Lassau. Leeburn, trying to fight. Leeburn again! Oh, that wasn't quite as close as pitchers, but it wasn't far away. And Charlton throwing themselves now at Blackburn, and Leeburn hit that well. Flowers again was at full length there with the dive. Now then. Jason Wilcox, Shearer and Pierce wait in the middle. Batty joins them now. So does Lassau. Batty. Wilcox. Shearer is near post, away by McCleary. They've defended so well in those positions. That was Moran to Marker. Shearer's still in there. This is Pierce. And the former Chelsea player could have snatched it there. Perhaps he did snatch a little bit too much at it, in fairness, for Blackburn. Shearer set the thing up, and it was an inviting ball on the volley for Ian Pierce. Ripley. Charlton, here's Brown. Leeburn on the far side might win this. In goes Pardew. Here comes Walsh, Colin Walsh. Oh, deflection, corner. That could have spooned over Flowers, but it did, but it could have dropped on another day under the bar from Colin Walsh. Pardew is there. His pitcher. Chappell hanging about, still on the far post, but it comes to nothing. Well, the three moments that you'll remember from this second half have all happened at the Blackburn end, really. Shots going against the post from this man, pitcher, just wide from Leeburn, and then a moment ago deflected over the bar from Walsh. Charlton have given it their best shots. And the tie goes back to Ewood Park the week after next. Alan Kirbishley and Steve Gritt's team giving it all they had, coming close a couple of times in the second half, notably through Darren Pitcher. But Blackburn remained organised, even if today they were far from inspired. And the final score at the Valley is Charlton Athletic 0, Blackburn Rovers 0.
Well, that was fiercely contested, that one today.
A real cup tie, wasn't it? And Charlton played really well. Hit the post and they might have had a couple of penalties as well.
Let's look at them now.
Yeah, it's just a ball over the top. This is the first half. And Leeburn gets onto it quick. I think he leaves Marker here for a bit of pace. The right hand comes out. And I think that might have been a push. I've definitely seen them given before. And the second one comes from a corner. Leeburn again. Watch him here. When it comes in, it gets flicked on. A little bit of movement. Sherwood, number four, comes at the back of him, and a little tug of the shirt. I'm not saying he would have scored, but I definitely think it's a little pull there, and they might be aggrieved about a couple of these decisions.
Charlton's still very much in it. Right, a big day in Kidderminster today. The Harriers were the only non-league team represented in the fourth round. They were at home to Preston North End, once proud cup winners, of course. David Davis reports.
One thing's for certain, only Kidderminster brought their fans to a cup tie today by steam train. The first football specials on the Severn Valley Railway in more than 100 years, they said. Yes, a very special day. And in the town, 2 hours before kick-off, even the Saturday shoppers weren't allowed to forget how special it was for the Harriers. But could it equal, even surpass, the thrill of beating Birmingham in the third round? The Agbra Stadium was ready for its biggest crowd in modern times, and down in Secretary Ray Mercer's cramped office, he was getting used to the sensation of sharing the sports pages of the Times with a New England coach.
I've been here for 34 years, never known anything like it, absolutely superb. I mean, the club 108 years old, biggest day today, biggest attendance, biggest gate receipts money-wise, absolutely super day. Everybody's been looking forward to it all the week, absolutely brilliant day in the history of Kidderminster Harriers.
And what about sharing a full page of the Times with Terry Venables?
Well, Terry Venables would probably saying, who's that on his page?
Out on the pitch, the omens for Harriers were starting to look quite good. Paul Davis, more than 500 games, almost 250 goals for the club, passed his fitness test on his hamstring. And manager Graham Allner also knew there was no danger of his Vauxhall Conference side having any inferiority complex when kick-off time arrived.
Obviously, the pros train full-time and we train a couple of times a week. But from a quality point of view, there's a lot of our lads couldn't afford to play in the lower divisions of the Football League. And I honestly think, I mean, we played Birmingham, and really, although we were up against it in the last couple of minutes, you wouldn't have thought that we were part-timers playing full-timers.
So Preston, twice proud FA Cup winners against Harriers, who apart from an FA Trophy success, boast 19 triumphs in the Worcester Senior Cup. Not that the Preston manager John Beck would have had any illusions about the problems to come. The outcome might have been different had Preston taken one of their early chances. Mick Conroy didn't enjoy his day. The better football along the ground was certainly being played at the other end. Neil Cartwright, who scored against Birmingham, was disappointed not to do so again today. But often Harrier's best chance seemed likely to be created down the other flank by John Purdy, once of Arsenal and Wolves. And that's just what happened 2 minutes into the second half. Purdy's run taking him almost from the halfway line to the byline. And Delwyn Humphreys, Harrier's top scorer, saying thank you and then giving even Peter Beagrie of Everton a lesson in the art of backflipping. Not a goal to see again if you're a Preston defender, but one for the video collection in Worcestershire. And there might have been another one 3 minutes later. Again, John Purdy involved at the far post, but more Humphreys gymnastics denied by the bar. A Preston equaliser would have been immensely cruel to the home side. The chance, though, wasted by sub Mickey Norbury, who'd been on the pitch barely 2 minutes. After that, Kidderminster had a few alarms, but frankly, very few. In the end, another glory day for a club that almost folded 15 years ago. Only the fifth non-league club to reach the last 16 of the FA Cup, the first in 9 years. And a day when some people's dreams came true. Worcestershire, without a league club at all, isn't used to this sort of celebration, you know.
You have your dreams before the beginning of the season, but you don't think they're going to come true. And on a day like this, I mean, it was a very hot. We knew what they were going to play like, and we always knew we got to defend well, which the lads, they were brilliant at the back. But we always knew if we got one or two chances, we'd put them away. And luckily enough, I was the one who got the chance and put it away.
Graham, many congratulations. An even prouder day than when you won at Birmingham?
Yeah, I think there was a lot of people had a lot of doubts about this game, me included, because the Birmingham one was a fairy tale and it happens once, it never happens again. Preston make life difficult for opposition and we knew that. And the feeling was that maybe we'd had our day and it would be very difficult to repeat it.
So looking ahead, though, to the fifth round of the Cup?
Yes, it'd be nice. I mean, I think a few of us are coming up tomorrow to the club to watch the United game and hopefully get United in the fifth round.
It's the draw right after the live match tomorrow. Well, now the all-premiership tie between Ipswich and Tottenham. Spurs just about scraped into this round, of course, on penalties against Peterborough. They're tumbling down the league as well. Ipswich, just one defeat in 13 games. At Portman Road, Clive Tyldesley.
This would have been Jason Dizell's testimonial year with Ipswich Town if he'd stayed. Dizell's £1.75 million switch in the summer was a sign of his and Tottenham's ambitions for the season. Now those ambitions are confined to the FA Cup. It was Dizell's late equaliser at Peterborough which kept Spurs in the Cup, and the penalty save of Ian Walker which squeezed them through the shootout. He's looking forward to a two-month run in the side now that Erik Torsvet has joined the casualty list. The average age of Ozzie Ardiles' team today, just 23. Ipswich Town crept through the third round too. An extra time replay winner gifted by Swindon to leading scorer Ian Marshall did the trick. Bulgarian Boncho Genchev is preferred to Chris Kiwomya as Marshall's striking partner. Dermot Gallagher proudly displaying his FIFA badge is the man in charge. It's the last weekend in January and Tottenham Hotspur are still looking for their first victory of 1994. They've lost to all five of the Premiership teams that they faced since the turn of the year. They really are searching for a foothold in a troubled season. But so often it's the Cup that brings the best out of Spurs. Dean Austin there right back. Darren Anderton, one of three players to pass morning fitness tests. And they really would have been down to the bare bones without those three. David Linigan, whose brother Andy, of course, scored the FA Cup winner last May for Arsenal. Samways. Adderton. Slick Thompson, but not Johnson. Austin just managed to keep it in, and Johnson has conceded the corner. Good to see him back after another major knee operation. He's had two in the last 3 years, Gavin Johnson. It's towards Dizel. It's come for Calderwood, and it came to him so quickly he couldn't control it. But it's been a promising start for Tottenham. Into a good position. Tracked by Sedgley. Slater, headed by Nethercott. This is Williams. Stockwell racing beyond him. Instead towards Marshall. Walker committed! Corner kick is the verdict. Stuart Nethercott and Ian Walker going for the same ball. And the goalkeeper didn't quite get there. Towards Walk, and Sedgley had to get the vital touch that time. Thompson's corner causing some problems for Spurs. It'll be Gedchev's turn now from the left flank. Lynam beyond the far post, blocked and smuggled away. Austin got a touch, Lynam denied. Turning up the volume inside Portman Road. Spurs hemmed in. It's Thompson. Orn Walk got to that one, but goal kick given the Bournemouth already across the dead ball line. But a whole array of corners from Ipswich Town. Stretching Tottenham Hotspur's defensive resources to the limit. John Walk couldn't quite squeeze that one back. Place to make a judgment, and he clearly pointed to his chest, but which part of Craig Forrest's anatomy blocked the shot from Barmby? Well, it looked like he turned into it and caught it with his right elbow. Yowls to Slater. Brought down by Calderwood. Typical skipping run from Stuart Slater. Minutes of the half remaining. It's Thompson, slipped into Slater, headed from Austin, has found Marshall, but there's a handball there. Ian Marshall was offside in actual fact. Or was he? Yeah, just. Austin. Towards Dizel, just couldn't quite grow enough. Edinburgh. Sedgley. Flick was from Johnson, it's come for Barmby. Oh, and turned away by Lynam with Anderson waiting to pounce. Tottenham don't need telling what a hole Teddy Sheringham's injury has left in their hopes and plans for the season. They were fifth at the table when he was injured at Old Trafford in October. They're now 15th, and Sheringham still comfortably their leading scorer. Just can't find that killer touch at the moment. Sheringham watches on from the stands as Stockwell brings Ipswich clear. Gedchev. Good challenge that by Nethercott. That's a very accomplished young defender. Ipswich corner. And that means Neil Thompson from this right-hand side, and that means Walker Linnigan forward. Thompson to fire it in. Walk beyond the back post, it's Marshall! And Ian Marshall, who saw Swindon Town in the third round, has put Tottenham Hotspur behind in the fourth. Ipswich Town's leading scorer lashes the ball into the top of the net, and no surprise that it came from a corner. Walt knocked it down, and Marshall knocked it high into the roof of the net. And all credit to Mick McGibbon and the work that's been done on the training grounds, because Ipswich have been dangerous from just about every corner. Ian Marshall has scored four of Ipswich Town's five goals since his return to the side on New Year's Day. That's number 12 of the season. Williams. Thompson. On the back heel, Thompson, good save. He's got almost a year without a goal, Neil Thompson, which is a mystery when you see how powerfully he strikes the ball with his left foot. Anderton. Caskey. In towards Sedgley. One or two hearts in mouths in that Ipswich goal mouth then. Steve Sedgley got up well beyond the far post. It was a searching cross from Caskey. Some encouragement for Tottenham. Nicely played by Williams. This is Johnson. Ooh, and it was only just in front of Getchev. Good defending again from Nethercock. Getchev will take it. In towards Walk, oh, it's a free header, but it's gone in off Johnson. 2-0 Ipswich lead. John Walk, who really should have buried the header, but it was his colleague, Gavin Johnson, who was an innocent bystander, really, who I think got the final touch. A curious goal, but it's another goal from a corner. And Tottenham just haven't been able to deal with them. Definitely Johnson. Anderton. Oh, marvellous run by Darren Anderton. Saul Campbell up at his shoulder here. In towards Caskey. Came off John Walk, it'll be a corner. Still one or two little glimmers of hope for Tottenham. But it's been a performance which has summed up their season in so many ways. Attractive to watch, neat and purposeful. But it's lacked that knockout blow. Good jabs, no body punches. Here's Edinburgh trying to provide one, he nearly did. Well, any source will do. Just in Edinburgh. He's only ever scored once for Spurs in more than 100 games for the club. He would have been an unlikely saviour, but he only missed by a foot. Thompson. Onside, Getchev. Marshall trying to get there in support of him. It's going to be Thompson. It's the end of the road to Wembley for Tottenham Hotspur. It could be the start of something big for Ipswich Town. Neil Thompson's first goal for almost a year seals it with 5 minutes to go. Played in by Getchev. And Thompson, who theoretically anyway is so dangerous with that left foot of his, realises potential with just 5 minutes remaining. It's 3-0. some ways. Here's Campbell. Still Tottenham pass. Trying to thread a way through. Austin. Here's Bambi, and they found a way through. Have they known? Off Forrest and off the bar. And that is Tottenham's afternoon in a moment. It was a tremendous save, in fairness. Barbie will be disappointed. Craig Forrest spread himself, and there's plenty of him. It's a good save, actually. It was an awkward height for him. He can't believe it. Anderton this time. And Calderwood over the top. Not your day, is it? But amidst all the headlines that will inevitably accompany Tottenham Hotspur's exit and all the questions that will be asked about the remainder of their season, let's not lose sight of the part that Ipswich have played in engineering a deserved victory. It's Ipswich Town ahead for the last 16, and the season's last chance of glory slips through Tottenham's hands. Gavin Johnson got the second of the two corner kick goals. And Ipswich Town are in the fifth round via triumphs over Premiership opposition. Impressive cup credentials. Spurs season is reduced to a survival game, and they may need a couple of new faces to be sure of winning it. But here in East Anglia, Ipswich Town have completed the first leg of what, who knows, may be a famous double. Ipswich Town 3, Tottenham Hotspur 0.
Your manager, Mick McGinn, very thorough, particularly on the opposition. What did he tell you about Tottenham today?
Well, he went to watch them against Swindon, and he made a few points that where we could get at them, which was corners, really, one of the main things. And we got, I think, was our first two goals from corners, so it worked well.
You could have had more than a couple, really, from corners too.
Yeah, we were quite hard on corners, and I don't think Tottenham have got that many big players in the team, so we did have a height advantage as well.
Now, where does he come from? Most emphatic win of the day in the Cup, that was, Trevor.
Yeah, it's a good scoreline. And, Ipswich have played very well. They deserve the victory. Well done to them. But also, the last couple of months in the league, they've been sort of playing well and improving their position. I think, more than anything, Spurs will get the headlines. And I think we've mentioned Teddy Sheringham being out and not scoring the goals. But I think the last couple of games and today, they look poor defensively. There were weak goals on the crosses, particularly corner kicks. And, that's something, if they're going to keep out of that relegation issue, they'll have to make sure they don't concede soft goals like they did today.
Thank you. Well, in the other all-premiership tie at Stamford Bridge, it was 1-1, Gavin Peacock for Chelsea, Graham Hyde for Sheffield Wednesday. Leeds United were in trouble at 2-2 away to First Division strugglers Oxford, scorers Alex Dyer and Matthew Elliott. But under replayers Gary Speed and David Weatherall replied. And another replay as West Ham came back after Gary Lunn's goal for Notts County, new boy Steve Jones scoring his second goal in two games this week. And you can see those goals among the fourth-round highlights at half-time in tomorrow's live game at Norwich. But now the goals from five other matches, starting with second favourites for the Cup, Newcastle, home to First Division Luton.
And it was the First Division side that made some early running. Both teams found the pitch difficult. Newcastle soon found out that Luton were going to be problematical. On his debut, Tony Thorpe memorably shot his side ahead 10 minutes before half-time. Still trailing and having missed chances with 30 minutes to go, Newcastle became slightly anxious. A Robert Lee header hit the bar. Newcastle, it seemed, were destined not to score today. They went and joined the ride on a bumpy pitch, so a sigh of relief came when John Dreyer's challenge on Peter Beardsley was judged a foul. A decision hotly disputed. There's evidence Beardsley's leg was hooked from under him. Beardsley himself took the penalty. A replay at Kenilworth Road is needed. Good result for Luton, though. Newcastle manager Kevin Keegan conducted his post-match press conference on the pitch to demonstrate his concern over its poor condition. He was less concerned about the scoreline. He judged that a fair result.
We created enough chances to win two or three matches, but they didn't go in. And, they battled and scrapped and they rode the luck at times. But I think they deserve to take us back to their place.
Wimbledon never need added incentives to give it their all, but then again, it doesn't hurt. John Scales had put £20 on himself to score the first goal at 40-1. The reason for the extra zealous celebrations, his teammates had also backed him and were collectively £3,000 better off. Wimbledon were cup winners in 88, Sunderland finalists two seasons ago. The Wembley pedigree was largely missing today, although Martin Smith's finishing in first-half injury time wasn't to be scoffed at. Sunderland level at 1-1. The First Division side had gone six games without defeat and had chances to win, but John Fashanu's determination, earlier a factor in a seemingly customary Selhurst Park scuffle, brought him and Wimbledon a place in round five.
Premier League Oldham and First Division Stoke will both be in tomorrow's draw, but everyone agreed it was by no means a classic at Boundary Park. Proof of that, Chris Makin's cross was one of Oldham's best efforts. Stoke looked capable of scoring on the break as the game wore on. From Toddy Orlickson's cross, Martin Carruthers directed a header wide, but on balance, it's Stoke who'll be the more satisfied.
The Cup's renowned for its quirks of fate. Pitching former Nottingham Forest teammates Peter Shilton and Viv Anderson together was one of them. Both now managers, Anderson's Barnsley a division higher and a goal ahead through Andy Payton's clever finish from Andy Coman's mistake. The first goal Plymouth had conceded in four Cup rounds this season. But Shilton's team were level soon after the break with one of the more spectacular efforts of fourth round day. Dwight Marshall giving us a glimpse of the kind of form which has seen Plymouth go 12 games unbeaten. Just 9 minutes later, they were ahead. And again, this wasn't just any old goal. Winger Paul Dalton put his head down, went for goal, and found it. That was 2-1 for the second division side. But captain Jerry Taggart ensured Barnsley had an opportunity to make it to the fifth round for the third year running. A 71st minute equaliser, giving Shilton and Anderson a chance to meet again a week on Wednesday.
First Division Wolves took a step nearer both Wembley and the Bahamas by winning at Second Division Port Vale. Club president Sir Jack Haywood has dangled the Bahamas as the carrot for a lengthy cup run. Paul Blade's first half header brought the palm trees a little nearer anyway. Wolves were never totally in command though. Port Vale had chances to equalise. The tie eventually decided a minute from time. Kevin Keane swept the ball in at the far post. Wolves are in the fifth round for the first time in 13 years. But centre-forward Steve Bull picked up a fresh injury today.
Now, there are ways to spend Sunday afternoons and there are ways to spend Sunday afternoons. Here are some ways to spend tomorrow afternoon. So the laundromat opens tomorrow afternoon at 3 o'clock with that match and then, of course, the fifth round draw live after that. Now, as you saw at the start, Terry's with us, got the job. Congratulations. Relieved or worried?
Bit of both, really, I suppose.
It took a while, didn't it?
It took a long time, yeah.
Were you amazed and surprised at the amount of press attention the whole thing got? The fours and the against. I mean, people writing columns about whether you should have the job or not.
I find it incredible. I mean, I think the mere fact it did go on was a good thing from one way for me, that everyone was looking into everything they had to see to, which made it convincing, in my opinion. On the other hand, once they'd said that I was going to get the job, or I wasn't, they then had to keep speculating about it over that period of time. But it was quite incredible, really.
You can clear one thing up straight away. Is Jimmy going to be a number two?
You're telepathic, you are. The only thing you know is that I'll end up his assistant.
Absolutely. I mean, when you get a job like this, I mean, there's no sort of real brief that nobody says you've got to be in the office Monday and then on Wednesdays you do this. And I mean, how do you see the next sort of month or two? How have you thought about how you're going to plan the next month or two?
Well, really, there's not a lot of time now before the game. There's only 4 or 5 weeks and there's lots to be done. And I think that we'll need a lot of travelling, you know, getting in touch with different managers and asking them about their players, not only in a capacity as playing, but how adaptable they are for change and so forth. So there's plenty to be done, but as you say, it's not really a 9-to-5 job, no.
Yeah. What sort of responsibilities exactly will you have? Is it just for the main England team, or will it be for the under-21 team as well? And
I'll have a big say on the under-21, but really it's the A side is the important thing. This is what we've got to really work at to try and get some improvement. Mm. And I think that's all you can expect, is that if you get improvement, you're on your way. People don't really expect to win every match. I mean, they do, but at the same time, when they look at it logically, they say, well, we're playing quite well. It looks like we're getting a stronger side, and there's improvement. And, you can't be a magician, but you've got to try, and that's as much as you can expect.
You will only be as good as the players allow you to be. And, and critics do say at the present time, look, in England, with respect to them, the players aren't good enough. I mean, how do you feel
about
that?
I think we've got a lot of good players. I think that we've got the potential, as I'd said yesterday, but the potential and reality are two different things. And that's really what we've got to try and do, is get the most out of those players. And in a very short time, working together to try and get a system of play working that they will be in no doubt of what they're doing. Mm.
So does that mean that you would play with a constant system? Do you think?
No, what I'm trying to do is to get a system that, but with a minimum amount of change, that you can actually change that system when things are not going well. If things are going well, you just leave it as it is. Mm-hmm. But if sometimes, no matter what you do, you can't get any space. Mm. If you can get a change of tactic in a minimum amount of time, I think that's important too.
Have you got in your mind's eye right now, this minute, what sort of team you would like to see out there? Players. You're not going to name them, obviously.
No.
Right, they can't possibly.
No,
but
that's
But I'm not that naive. Have you got sort of 5 or 6, 7 players right at this minute that you would say they would be in my team if they're fit and well right now?
I think it's fair to say that you've got certain players that you feel would be in your first squad. Also, you've got to get the short-term thing of trying to win again, and yet at the same time, everyone would be saying, well, really, you've got to be prepared for 2.5 years' time when the European Championships come round. Mm-hmm. That's really what you're after. Mm. At the same time, you don't want to be losing on the way because of the confidence factor. Yeah.
Is Gascoigne going to figure in your plans very much?
I expect he will be around the scene, I expect. We thought we'd got rid of each other, actually, but it doesn't look like we have.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you'll go to Italy and over the next turn.
I would say I'll get around to try and speak to most of the players. Mm-hmm. Mm.
The first game is Denmark, isn't it?
Yes.
You said just now that you wouldn't want to really. You obviously don't want to lose any game. Mm. But I mean, are you prepared? Are you sort of brave enough to lose those games in a sense and take the press flak that'll come your way? When you're really looking in the long term?
I think you've got to be prepared to be brave on certain issues. It's about knowing players you think would do the job. It's putting the white shirt on and enjoying it, or feeling a bit concerned. It's just like going to Manchester United, Liverpool, these big clubs. Some players take to it straight away and other players are a little bit concerned. But you've got to find that out. It's no good having it in your own mind. You've got to find out whether that they're going to be able to do it. So you've got to take those risks, and we've got a period of time where we can work at it. Mm.
We wish you all the best.
Thanks.
And if you play your cards right, you'll get your name in the papers occasionally. Well done, Terry. Thank you very much. Join us, won't you, tomorrow for the live one, Norwich against Manchester United, and that draw live. Bye-bye.
Sports, 61 events, only one channel, the 1994 Winter Olympics on BBC Two.